We now begin with our third session, which is on a relevant and very vital topic of legal, ethical, and medical challenges in the medical healthcare. Ladies and gentlemen, the society has transformed, and with time, traditional medical ethics has changed into an interdisciplinary field involving lawyers, philosophers, social scientists, physicians, and other health professionals. This change is due to the increasing impact of science and technology, the growth of specialization in the field of medicine, public expectations from new medicines and surgical techniques. Ladies and gentlemen, it is felt that the field of medical ethics, which focused initially only on the moral responsibility of a physician towards a patient, was not adequate to address the ethical aspects emerging out of the challenging healthcare environment. This session begins with a keynote address, which is followed by the panel discussion. And ladies and gentlemen, the questions from the house will be addressed during the panel discussion. Now we request Honorable Justice Pramod Kohli, sir, Chairman Central Administrative Tribunal and former Chief Justice of Sikkim, the keynote speaker for this session, to please come on the stage to chair the session. I would also like to request Lieutenant General Dr. N.K. Parmar, Param Vishisht Seva Medal, Ati Vishisht Seva Medal, Veer Chakra, Vishisht Seva Medal, and CEO of Karnataka Region Apollo Hospitals, Bangalore, to please come on the stage to take his place.
Now we call upon Dr. K.K. Talwar, Chairman Cardiology, Max Healthcare, Max Super Speciality Hospital, Saket, to please come on the stage. We request Professor Nitin Madhusudan Nagarkar, Director AIIMS Raipur, to please come on the stage. Mr. Anil Anand, Senior Journalist, New Delhi, is requested to please come on the stage for the panel discussion. We request Colonel Abhijit Rudra, Professor and Head, Department of Forensic Medicine, FMC Pune, the moderator for this session, to please come on the stage.
Ladies and gentlemen, Justice Pramod Kohli, after graduation, secured degree of law from University of Jammu in the year 1972. He joined bar at Jammu and was appointed as Advocate General of the Jammu and Kashmir State in December 1990. He is the man of integrity, which is reflected with the fact that Justice Pramod Kohli opted for his transfer from the state of Jammu and Kashmir when his sons joined the legal services over there. He was Chief Justice of Honorable High Court of Sikkim, and presently he is the Chairman of the Central Administrative Tribunal, CAT, since 2016. Now I request Honorable Justice Pramod Kohli to please deliver his keynote address.
A very good afternoon to all of you. Dr. D.K. Sharma, Dr. Siddharth Satpathy, Dr. Shakti Gupta, Dr. Vijay Tadia, Dr. K.K. Talwar, Dr. Parmar, Dr. Rudra Dutt, and my friend Anil Anand, eminent doctors from various fields, ladies and gentlemen. Today's topic of debate in this session is of great importance and significance. The medical profession is most revered and noble profession since times immemorial. Even when there were no medical colleges, no regulatory mechanism, no technology, no institutional research, but the medicines and treatment were invented by the persons based upon their personal knowledge, wisdom, and experiences. The topic is not relevant only for medical professionals, but for the patients, medical students, paramedical staff, and all those who are associated with the medical profession are providing ancillary services. The caption of the topic is itself suggestive of three prime challenges to the medical profession: legal, ethical, and moral. The legal challenges can be confined to violation and contravention of statutory provisions, laid down norms, and conduct which may amount to a criminal or tortious act. The ethical and moral conduct inter alia includes a host of activities, may not be regulated by any law, but fall in the realm of right and wrong. Concerning the autonomy of patient, any act of misfeasance, malfeasance, and non-feasance in a given situation. It may not be possible to prescribe any thumb rule or define the ethical and moral conduct confining to few or some activities. The ethical and moral conduct of a professional inter alia includes even such activities and actions which may not be routine happenings and can only be tested on the touchstone of prudence in a given situation. The medical profession is known since the ages. In the modern world, the medical profession has fundamentally three kinds of obligations: legal obligation, professional obligation, and human obligation. Legal obligation of a physician or a medical practitioner are regulated by various laws. In India, such obligations are prescribed under the Medical Council of India Act 1956 and many enactments like Drugs and Cosmetics Act, Pharmacy Act, Narcotic Drugs and Psychotropic Substances Act, Medical Termination of Pregnancy Act, Transplantation of Human Organ Act, Mental Health Act, Environmental Protection Act, Prenatal Sex Determination Test Act, Drugs and Magic Remedies, Objectionable Advertisement Act, Persons with Disabilities, Equal Opportunities and Full Participation Act, and Biomedical Waste Management Rules and such other enactments. Regulations made by the central state governments or local administrative bodies or any other relevant act relating to the protection and promotion of public health. MCA Act laid down norms right from the stage of establishment of a medical college to the time of admission to medical courses, the mode and method of selection, the recognition of the institution imparting medical courses, the qualifications of the faculty engaged in teaching the students, and the essentiality of various courses of study. Registration with the state Indian Medical Council on acquiring the qualifications. Apart from qualifications, do's and don'ts are prescribed under the Indian Medical Council Act, and rules and regulations framed thereunder. There is also a legal obligation to acquire minimum prescribed skill and knowledge for the discharge of professional obligations, to be careful in performance of duties as may be required. Professional obligation is necessarily legal obligation too. It is, however, something beyond the legal field, which may include the behavioral aspects of the doctors, commitment to the duty, observance of transparency in its actions, and secrecy in respect of the autonomy of the patient, and also observance of various other aspects. As a matter of fact, the Indian Medical Council has framed regulations known as the Indian Medical Council Professional Conduct, Etiquette and Ethics Regulation 2002. As many as 8 chapters are incorporated in the regulations prescribing do's and don'ts to be observed by a physician. Chapter 3 thereof prescribes duties of physicians in consultation. A consultation should be resorted to in cases of serious illness, doubtful or difficult conditions, and unnecessary consultation should be justifiable in the interest of the patient only. Pathological, radiological, and diagnostic investigations should be done judiciously. Such consultation should be for the benefit of the patient. Observance of punctuality in consultation, information to the patient regarding such consultation before and after, display of fee and other charges in a transparent manner. Similarly, Chapter 1 of the regulations require a physician to maintain medical records, display of registration, use of generic names of drugs, ensuring highest quality in patient care, exposure of unethical conduct, payment of professional services, prognosis, etc. He is also required to indulge in not to indulge in unethical acts as prescribed under the Chapter 6 of the regulations, like advertisement, soliciting patients directly or indirectly by institutions or organizations. The expression ethics and morality, if not synonyms, are similar in nature. An act to be ethical must have moral sanction. In ancient India, the morality means value system which was influenced by all religions. Be it Hinduism, Buddhism or Jainism, according to Vedas, the call to love your behavior as yourself is because the neighbor is in truth the very self, and what separates you from him is mere illusion, Maya. The philosophy of Atma embraces Paramatma or Brahma, and that all human beings are the product of Paramatma is the core belief. The Hindu philosophy of Vasudeva Kutumbakam is a belief that all human beings are children of one God. This is also the philosophy of Christianity, Islam, Buddhism, and Jainism. Ayurveda, the ancient science of life, was based upon the principles of management in health and disease and the code of conduct of the physicians. The objective of medicine is twofold: preservation of good health and combating disease. It was believed that there is need for healthy lifestyle, which includes cleanliness and purity, good diet, proper behavior, mental and physical discipline. To achieve this objective, it is imperative to take pure water, jalasuddhi, clean food, ahara suddhi, clean body, deha suddhi, and above all, pure mind, mana suddhi, and clean environment, that is desha suddhi. The earlier healthcare system was based upon the philosophy of treating the whole body and even something beyond mind. The earliest protagonists of Indian medicine, such as Atreya, Kashyapa, Bhela, Charaka, and Susruta, have based their systems on foundations of spiritual philosophy and ethics. Thus, the ethic is the concept of right and wrong and have its genesis in spirituality. There does not seem to be any distinction between ethics and morality. What is perceived to be moral is ethical. A medical profession deals with human beings, and thus he has to be motivated by humanistic ideals and compassion. Just like a judge is said to discharge divine duty, similarly, a doctor is considered to be an arm of the God. That is the pedestal at which the medical profession stands. It is very difficult to define expression ethics or morality. The term ethics has been derived from ancient Greek word which means ethos, and ethos represent the habit and custom. In fact, the expression ethics can be summed up as a mechanism of achieving righteousness. Aristotle, the great philosopher of his time, defined ethical system as self-realization. When a person acts in accordance with his nature and he realizes his full potential, he will do well and be content. According to Aristotle, the purpose of ethics is to become good, not merely to know. He mentioned the ultimate purpose of life is to achieve happiness, and happiness can be achieved by self-realization of the potential of a person. According to Aristotle's philosophy, one attains happiness by a virtuous life and the development of reason and the faculty of the theoretical wisdom. For this, one requires sufficient external goods to ensure health, leisure, and the opportunity for virtuous actions. Moral virtue is acquired by a combination of knowledge, habituation, and self-discipline. Virtuous acts require conscious choice and moral purpose or motivation. A man has personal moral responsibility for his actions. In the context of ethics for the medical professionals, in recent times, the regulations framed under the Indian Medical Council Act 1956 has framed code of medical ethics in the form of declarations and duties prescribed for the physicians. Chapter 1 of the regulations has many do's and don'ts which are part of the ethical code for medical practitioners. That one of such code being, a physician shall uphold the dignity and honor of his profession. I believe this expression embraces even undefined facets of medical professions. The role of doctors has also attracted the attention of the courts of the country, particularly after the consumer laws came to be enacted. One of such famous judgments is in the case of Pandit Paramanand Katara versus Union of India, perhaps one of the oldest judgments delivered in 1989. A writ petition under Article 32 of the Constitution of India was filed. The main object of this petition was to seek directions for saving the life of an injured who is brought to a hospital in a precarious position for his immediate treatment without insisting for completion of medico-legal formalities. A report in Hindustan Times prompted the petitioner to file this writ petition. The newspaper referred to a case of a scooterist who was hit by a speeding car. A person who was passing through, seeing a man profusely bleeding, took him to the nearest hospital. The doctor refused to attend the injured and advised the person to take the patient to named different hospital located about 20 kilometers away, authorized to handle medico-legal cases. Victim was carried to the said hospital. However, he succumbed to his injuries. Apart from Union of India, Medical Council of India, and Indian Medical Association were also implicated as parties. The Secretary, Ministry of Health and Family Welfare filed an affidavit referring to proceedings of a meeting held on 29th May 1986 under the chairmanship of Director General of Health Services, wherein a decision was taken on the basis of a report of subcommittee set up by the Home Department of Delhi Administration in May 1983 on medico-legal cases. The decision was taken in the said meeting under the caption, Obligations to Seek. It was noticed that though a physician is not bound to treat each and every one asking his services, except in emergencies, for the sake of humanity and noble traditions of the profession. Not only that, he should be responsible to the calls of the sick and injured, but he should be mindful of a higher character of his mission and responsibility. It was noticed that the patient should not be neglected and the doctor should respond to an emergency. He should not ignore the patient, nor should he withdraw from the case without giving notice to the patient. The Indian Medical Association expressed its apprehension that the doctors who treat the injured under such conditions are harassed by the police and dragged to the courts. Under the directions of the Honorable Supreme Court, the Medical Council of India placed before the court a copy of the Code of Medical Ethics indicating that there is no provision in law justifying the attitude of the doctors in refusing to treat the injured immediately. It is a part of their professional duties and professional ethics to start treating the patient as soon as he is brought before the doctor for medical attention. The paramount obligation of the doctor to save human life with a view to preserving his life. It is unfortunate and a matter of concern to note that this judgment was delivered in 1989, and even after 20 years, the ground realities have hardly changed except in few urban areas. This judgment pertained only to one challenge which was being faced by the medical community in regard to the immediate treatment to the serious and injured patients. Brought to hospitals, there are various other challenges. It has been experienced by many members of the society, and it is no secret that in recent times, maybe in the last two decades, many aberrations have intersected the medical profession. It may be a fringe element, but such aberrations have impacted the profession as a whole. It is not that there are no aberrations in other professions, but the medical profession being such that a common man is directly concerned, the aberrations become more visible and prominent, particularly in view of the free media, both print and visual, where even a small incident is blown out of proportions to make news. It is in this context that even a small component of professionals who indulge in unethical practices render a bad name to the entire medical profession. A recent study conducted by one Dr. Arun Gadre and Dr. Abhay Shukla, published in their book, Dissenting Diagnosis, is an account of growing unethical practices in the medical profession in India. The study is based on interviews of 78 doctors in the medical profession from the cities of Bangalore, Chennai, Delhi, Kolkata, Mumbai, Nasik, Pune, and some small and medium-sized towns in Maharashtra and Chhattisgarh. The study depicts malpractices, particularly in private hospitals, in the areas like diagnosis, unnecessary procedures, surgeries, commission-cum-cut practice, inflated bills, prescription of inappropriate medicines, questionable degrees, and treatment without required knowledge. The book gives startling revelations of such malpractices prevailing in the medical profession. It goes without saying that the technology in medical science has over the years brought a sea change in diagnosis, identification of the disease, and particularly in the field of surgical interventional treatment. But it is not necessary that in every case, the diagnosis must be carried out through technology. Under the garb of facilitating the diagnosis, unnecessary tests are being conducted, and some of such tests are invasive, in character, pricking the human body time and again, radiation, and various other adverse implications are invited, not for the purposes of necessity, but for various extraneous considerations. It is no secret that the practice of cuts and commissions in various tests and diagnoses is a common practice in the medical profession. Okay. The second aspect is influence and control of pharmaceutical companies. It is again a known factor that prescriptions are made at the behest or asking of some of the companies. The companies allure some of the medical professionals with cash gifts, monetary grants, travel facilities, and so many other aspects. The commercialization of profession is also not a secret. But another area of concern to my knowledge is that in some of the substandard medical institutions, importing undergraduates and postgraduate courses, some of the doctors have enrolled themselves with various medical colleges, even far away places where they can hardly reach on the same day, charging hefty amounts merely to facilitate the inspections by MCI for recognition of medical institutions. It's a sad affair that some of the members of the faculty facilitate the students to acquire undeserved medical degrees for monetary considerations and even sexual favors. One can imagine the caliber of such doctors who would acquire degrees by such unethical means. Because of the paucity of time, I may not refer to some of the very important judgments of the Supreme Court, but one judgment I would definitely like to just mention, that is Martin D. Souza versus Muhammad Ishfaq. The court, it was a bench of Justice Marquette de Cardew and Justice R.M. Lodha, held that first complaints of medical negligence to a competent doctor, they held that courts must refer complaints of medical negligence to a competent doctor or a panel of experts in the field before issuing notice to the allegedly negligent doctor. This is necessary to avoid harassment to doctors who may not be ultimately found to be negligent. The courts also warned the police officials not to arrest the doctors unless the facts clearly come within the parameters laid down in another judgment, Jacob Matthew versus State of Punjab. In Indian Medical Service versus VP Shanta, the profession of doctors had been brought within the definition of service under the Consumer Protection Act. And thus, there is no escape to the liability under the provisions of the aforesaid Act. No thumb rule can be made for deciding under what situation a doctor or a hospital can be held responsible. It depends upon a particular situation in given circumstances where the wisdom, prudence of the medical practitioner and his skill and acumen is crucial and deciding factor. There are serious allegations against some private hospitals where the patient is kept in isolation and even attendants are not allowed to meet at occasions. There are allegations that patient was dead and still kept in the hospital for a few days just for sake of hefty bills. Such allegations do not seem to be true, but private hospitals need to be careful and some kind of transparency has to be brought in to repudiate such allegations. Admittedly, doctor's profession is noble and laudable profession. He is next to God while treating his her patient. The primary duty of the doctor is to save patient. I am reminded of a movie with the name Achanak. Most of you might have seen that movie, where an army personnel, finding his wife having an affair with another person in his absence, commits murder. He is convicted and awarded a sentence. He, however, fleds and chased by the police and receives injury in his heart. Doctors saved him as it was considered their moral and professional duty, notwithstanding the fact that ultimately he was to be hanged and killed. We are all aware of the fact that there is a huge deficiency of doctors in India. I will not go into the studies which have been carried out, but there are some revealing which all of you must have seen on TV. In Odisha, a man slung his wife's body over his shoulder and carried 10 kilometers on being denied ambulance. In Kanpur, a man's sixth son died on his shoulders after being denied admission to a hospital. I am conscious of the fact, rather I appreciate the commitment and patience of our doctors who withstand the pressure of patients. There is also a deficiency of paramedical staff. Our doctors are working under tremendous pressure, examining and treating hundreds and thousands of patients every day. This is equally true of premium institutions like AIIMS and PGI. The central government, state government must initiate steps for opening of new medical colleges and hospitals with adequate facilities. Fortunately, in recent budget, new medical colleges have been sanctioned and intake capacity of existing medical colleges has been enhanced. A study says that the healthcare in India is lowest among its BRICS countries. Every year, 55,000 doctors complete their MBBS and 25,000 postgraduates nationwide. With this growth rate, by the year 2020, with a population of 1.3 million, India may have 1:1250 ratio as present ratio of 1:1700. The professionals must observe professional and moral ethics, notwithstanding any regulatory provisions in any enactment. I believe inner conscience is the best guarantee for fair medical profession. Compassion and sensitivity is key to it. I convey my gratitude to the AIIMS management and especially to Dr. Shakti Gupta for providing me opportunity to be part of this debate. And with all of you, thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir, for sharing your experience, sir.
We now request Colonel Abhijit Rudra, the moderator for this session, to please begin the panel discussion.
Thank you. Ethics may be defined as the science of moral values, and medical ethics may therefore be described as the moral principles that should guide members of the medical profession in their dealings with each other, with their patients, and the state. Elevating the discussion to a conceptual level, an ethical practice of medicine elevates the level of care much above the minimum standards which are laid down by statutes and law. We are honored to have with us a panel of personalities of great eminence in their own fields of specialization. And we would like to request them to share with us their views on legal, ethical, and moral challenges which are there in medical practice from their point of view. I would like to set the ball rolling by asking Mr. Anil Anand, a very senior member of the Fourth Estate, about what he feels are the major differences in the philosophy and practice of ethics as it relates to healthcare, vis-a-vis what he has seen in his own field of journalism. Mr. Anand.
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. At the onset, I'm really thankful and my gratitude to Dr. Shakti Gupta, chairperson of the organizing committee of this all-important event, for inviting me to be part of this important conclave. First and foremost, as Minister of State Dr. Jitendra Singh tried to put it across, the title of this conclave, or the subject of this conclave, why? And he very rightly said, 10 years back, 20 years back, or 30 years back, nobody would have even discussed legal and ethics or morality in all these professions. Because these professions, medical profession as well as the profession to which I belong, they were highly rated, they were highly respected. So certain maladies have set in, which has resulted in all of us today gathering here in this hall and discussing the legal and ethical challenges in the field of healthcare, but also I would like to talk about media. And in that sense of the term, I will try to be more critical about myself than picking holes in the health sector and otherwise. I'm not a domain expert in any of the related fields like the legal or the healthcare or health science, medical science. I'm here to present a point of view as a journalist who has covered health sector for some years, seen certain good and bad trends from close proximity, and of course, some contribution from my side will be as a consumer also. I admit that as a journalist, I was a privileged consumer whenever I needed healthcare for myself or my family or friends. But that doesn't mean that what I experienced was all rosy. It was really painful sometimes when you suddenly saw attitudes changing and trends changing. I'm certainly not suggesting that in terms of ethics or moralities, certain things which were relevant, say, 50 or 100 years back are relevant even today also. The fundamentals remain the same, and a new edifice has to be built, even if afresh, through strengthening the same foundations. What is really happening is that we are shaking the foundations. We are trying to build an edifice in the air. So that is where most of the problems are coming. Getting back to the two questions which Colonel has asked me to address to, I'll be very brief. Many good things have also happened so far as growth of medical and media sectors are concerned. New heights have been scaled. The terms of technological advancement, which is a never-ending process also. From a journalist's perspective, I've seen the system drastically changing in the last 35 years. When I became a media professional as a young reporter, the change has been dramatic so far as technology and facilities are concerned. The change has also been dramatic so far as professional ethics are concerned. But sorry to say, more towards the downslide. There are various factors why this downslide, that could be a different debate altogether. There is a considerable erosion so far as following the worth ethics is concerned. And when I say this, I pointedly talk about media. Yes, under a free economy, no one can escape the effects, both good and bad, of commercialization. It is difficult to fathom that both media and medical worlds can remain untouched by these effects. The challenge lies how much safeguards can be adopted through a legal framework and more importantly, through a self-disciplinary mechanism. I was listening to Air Marshal Kapoor and Dr. Bijan Mishra in the beginning of this conclave, and I'm caught in a vortex after listening to them. It's my own confusion in my mind. Dr. Kapoor, Air Marshal Kapoor talked about laws, a lot of laws, framework. He talked about the medical profession. Dr. Bijan Mishra said there are too many laws. I'm at a very different position as a media person. Yes, you need safeguards. You need a legal framework. You need guidelines also. But my position is no law per se, a focused law guides me. There are no guidelines for me. We are just surviving on verbal guidelines which our teachers, our mentors, our older generations set in. If you say there is a legal framework for us, no. We have no legal framework. We have no guidelines. We have only one odd organization called Press Council of India, which is a toothless tiger, which has no powers. So coming on to the conflict between media and the medical profession now. Media has an important role in terms of disseminating information and creating awareness. And media is central to disseminating this information or whatever developments take place in the healthcare sector. Ultimately, the developments should reach the people, and there we play a vital role. To see the truth and present it to the viewers and readers is the basic duty of a journalist. The same principle could hold true for doctors and researchers in the medical field also. None of the two can afford the luxury of either self-propagation or self-aggrandizement, which, by the way, would eventually naturally come alongside one's achievements. But unfortunately, certain disturbing trends have set in which override the charter of ethical values. And these trends we are witnessing in the media more than in any other profession. There are problems in other areas also. This again brings me back to the question whether there should be a legal framework for the functioning of the media. Persons like me, we are strong votaries of freedom of press. Yes, there should be a framework, there should be guidelines, but certainly not to control the opinion. So the second question raised was that express some of my personal experiences while covering health sector or as a journalist overseeing health and other sectors in terms of confrontations and clashes. Three examples I'll quote from my personal experience without naming anyone before I conclude, just to drive home a point, how things can sometimes get astray and how the vested interests in media and in the healthcare sector or the medical profession, how the vested interests take benefit of this. First example I wanted to quote, my friend was here in the morning, he has left, Dr. A.K. Gupta, MS-PGI. When he went to Chandigarh to join as MS-PGI, he applied for a top post in AIMS from where he went. So one fine morning, I was working with the Hindustan Times at that point of time. One fine morning, I opened the newspaper, I saw a big news against Dr. A.K. Gupta flashed on the front page, top box. I was amazed on the content of the news. Amazed because I have known Dr. Gupta. He was my classmate in, not classmate, but batchmate in college in his pre-MBBS days. So I thought he had gone through all these drills. He was a very hardworking person. How come it happened to him? So the news was that one of his degrees is fake, and that too MBBS degree. I was just hopping mad. I said, how can it happen? As a journalist, somebody could have inquired. And he was a very prominent person. In any case, by the time I was discussing it with myself, in came Dr. Gupta's phone from Chandigarh. And he was hopping mad. He was abusing me also. Why this? Why that? I said, okay, hang on. I'm also trying to find out an answer to this question. So ultimately, I said, you come over to Delhi. Bring your original certificates. I'll seek an appointment with the editor and we'll go. So what happened now? How it happened? A very enthusiastic young health reporter. Obviously, we cultivate our sources, whichever beats we cover. He or she had a doctor named who was very friendly, who used to feed all of us with stories.
So a piece of paper came that such and such, this thing, he has a fake MBBS degree, dates are wrong, whatever wrong it is. So the story was done. So when Dr. Gupta came, we met the editor and the reporter was called. She said, no, I have this paper. So then ultimately inquiries revealed that there was a typographical error in that particular page which that doctor had removed from the file and given it to the reporter. So what I'm trying to say is, the major mistake made by the reporter was the total reliance on that source. It was such a major thing, it could have spoiled somebody's career, rightly or wrongly, that at least should have picked up a phone and tried to confirm it. The malady on the media side, the malady on the healthcare side, the doctor in his rivalry, he wanted to see that this man doesn't come and somebody else has to be projected, so a candidate come ho jayega. Yeah, I'm good. So second example, changing attitudes, which I spoke very, I'll take another half a minute. My father was suffering from a particular disease. It was about 15 years back. So he was treated in AIMS, a very good doctor, head of the department, very friendly to me. He always used to talk to me about in terms of ethics, professional ethics and all, and he treated my father very well. After 8 years, my father needed the same treatment again. I rang up and found that the doctor was retired and he's joined a private institution. That I didn't know. I got his number and called him up. So I could see the attitude change I am saying, which is another malady, which is the offshoot of commercialization and which needs to be checked even in the media as well as in the healthcare sector. So the doc saab, I found his language changed, totally changed. He was more talking in terms of marketing. And he said, I went to him, he checked my father. He said, he needs immediate surgery. So this is this, I'm just writing it, book a room downstairs and give this much, deposit this much amount. And when I went outside as this obedient son, I tried, the amount was big. I was a very small reporter then. I said, okay, I'll arrange the money. My father caught hold of my hand. He said, I'm not going to get this operation done. I've lost faith in this doctor. He's not the same doctor. So ultimately he asked me, I just want to go to AIMS once again if you can arrange, otherwise I'm going back to my home city, Jammu. I said, okay, let's try. So I took him to another doctor there. So ultimately it came down that my father never needed an operation until today. He's 85 and he's on that medication and doing very well. So I hope I just try to convey 2-3 scenarios and points and where media and healthcare is clashing. And we need to develop some laws alone will not make any difference. There are a lot of laws as Marshall Kapoor said, and Dr. Bijan Mishra objected to why so many laws. And there are no laws governing me. So we will have to find a mid path. Self-discipline, self-introspection, self-criticism, these things will have to be, and these would come from ethical values only. I don't know how can we restore these ethical values, but all of us would have to ponder over it. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Anand. You very succinctly brought out the issues related to self-regulation and accountability in both professional domains. I would now like to invite Dr. K.K. Talwar, Chairman of Cardiology of Max Healthcare, who is preeminent in the field of cardiology, apart from being an extremely astute administrator, on his views on the Consumer Protection Act. There was a feeling that the CPA was supposed to be a game changer. But has it lived up to its expectation of being an instrument for enhancing patient safety? Or has it encouraged defensive medicine with delays in patient care? Do you really feel, sir, that the Consumer Protection Act has helped the medical profession and society?
Thank you so much, and I first express my gratitude to Dr. Shakti Gupta for this opportunity. Honorable Justice Kohli, sir, and my panel colleagues. You see, a lot has been said in the inauguration time, and also Justice Kohli's declaration. I think time is limited. I mean, there's so many things as a professional I would like to interact or sort of give my sort of feelings. But I think time being limited, I will not go into that. I think one sentence which our Chief Guest mentioned, that when the Consumer Act came, neither the profession were happy and nor the society was happy probably. Of course, professionals were not happy because this may, people felt that something is going to be obstructing to them and checking them. But there are other issues. But what he said about the society, you see, what has happened, I mean, that the practice of medicine has become more defensive. I think that's what I think we sort of talk about, that over-investigations. Now a patient walks with a headache, and if a person doesn't do MRI, and tomorrow something comes out, he says, why you didn't think of it? I mean, though, I mean, clinical medicine is very vital. You are able to define which patient should go through or not go through. But this is what the medicine has been affected. The practice of medicine, over-investigation, I think is largely maybe also driven by this kind of thing. I will just like to sort of, while working as a professional and then 2 years in medical council and then we used to hear a lot of things, I'll just wanted to actually narrate you two cases, and I think left and leaving it to you to judge about this, what to be done. The time being limited, I will not be able to go into detail. This is a one judgment came in 2005. This was the Supreme Court bench. This was Chief Justice R.C. Lahoti, Justice G.P. Mathur, and Bala Subramanian. This was a patient who went to the sort of 95, his father died, and because of he had a terminal cancer issue, the hospital, when he suddenly became very sick, probably the oxygen gas was not available, all the cylinder was not full, and anyway, patient was very sick, he passed away, but the family felt very agitated and went to the court. So the judicial magistrate, I think, framed charges under section 34A. I'm not very familiar with legal language, sir, please pardon me, and so I will not go more in detail. Anyway, he was the session judge also, framed this charge against the two doctors. The appellant filed a petition in the High Court under Section 482 of the Code of Criminal Procedure, praying for a quashing of the FIR and all the subsequent proceedings. But even the Honorable High Court did not agree, and the trial should go on. It is at this stage, I think, the sufferer went to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court, I think. And I will just give you the gist of, because of the paucity of time. Reverting back to we are satisfied that all the averments made in the complaint, even if held to be proved, do not make out a case of criminal rashness or negligence. So this is 95 the case started, 2005 the judgment came. So I think the Honorable Bench quashed the proceeding and said there's nothing in this, there's no negligence or any kind of thing. So it took 10 years for it to settle down. Now look at the professional who suffered for 10 years in that process. His growth, his commitment to his patients, his thinking. So this is something which I think should raise concerns, that after 10 years you say you are fine, but those 10 years that you went through those miseries, how you were performing your profession. I mean, there must be other examples. And one more example I like this, we have a very distinguished, outstanding surgeon in the country. I don't want to name him at the moment. In Bombay, he headed one of the top cancer centers in the country for many years, guided its growth. And one of the patients, who was again a cancer patient, went to USA, I mean, they also said nothing can be done. He came back to Bombay. Probably the treating physician asked him that we can also consult so and so. He said, okay, as a last resort, probably some surgery can be tried to give a chance, but I think there's no hope in a way. The treating surgeon did this surgery, and when he was doing surgery, found this real difficult. and there were some problems. He called that surgeon to whom this was consulted. He came from the other OT. He probably saw and felt, no, agree, nothing much can be closed. The patient developed some little complication. I mean, she was terminal anyway. The family, after she passed away, went to the court. It's 89-90 kind of thing. And again, the additional, I mean, metropolitan magistrate, the session judge, the high court, they considered that this is a case where I think he should be, is a negligence. And then 2013, this is a judgment by Justice A.K. Patnaik and Justice A.K. Sikri. And then they say, I mean, non-performance, I mean, his claim, his grudge was that the surgeon did not do the surgery himself, but she was under some different surgeon. And when he was told there's some kind of serious issue, he did not support him that time. Or why did he give this advice to have a surgery kind of thing? So, of course, I think, again, the Supreme Court said, though, there's no case for it. So it's bent on for so many years. So what I'm trying to share that I think this profession is getting affected by this particular thing, and there should be some way we need to address to it. I mean, idea is to give our best to the society, best to the patients. But if this kind of process is affected that way, I mean, we know, I mean, what is happening in American medicine. I'm sure there are countries like UK or other European countries, you don't see so much of litigation issues, what it is now happening here. So I will rather little sort of say that that is the time that should be some kind of a judicial experts or medical expert to sit together to see how best to achieve this kind of issues. And rather than, because I can imagine for 10, 15 years, some person is under this kind of a pressure, what will be his sort of a way of functioning or fate? And I'm sure it will be going to affect these careers. And some of you are, that's why in medicine, I think when this judgment was quoted by Justice Lohoti, and I'll just mention a little para, take a few minutes what they said. I think it will be. A medical practitioner faced with emergency ordinarily tries his best to wring the patient out of his sufferings. He does not do anything by acting by the negligence or by omitting to do an act. Obviously, therefore, it will be for the complainant to clearly make out a case of negligence before a medical practitioner is charged with or proceed against criminals, surgeons. If the hand of a surgeon are trembling with dangling fear of facing a criminal prosecution in the event of failure for whatever reason, whether attributable to himself or not, neither a surgeon nor a successfully wield his life-saving scalpel to perform an essential surgery. So, I mean, these are some of the issues we should look at, and I'm sure as far as the medical ethic, the MCI has an act which carries all, I think Justice Kohli has already deliberated upon that. There are ways, I mean, so I will say that there's a time to look into this again so as both to sort of the professionals feel confident in doing what they want to do. At the same time, I'm sure no doctor will like to do anything wrong to a patient if he doesn't get anything out of it. Thank you so much, Shakti. Again, I think time being limited, there were two more questions which I'll briefly answer. That was the medical education, ethical issues. There is an act, and I think during our MCI time, we passed the undergraduate career. We should have some kind of a session on humanities as well as medical ethics to treat. As far as there was another question was the cost of stents, I think this is an issue which is there in the press for the last some months. I think some of us who mentioned that the stent should be an essential item, this price should be regulated. Because the prices were not regulated, I was surprised in 2006 when I went to Canada for some kind of meeting, I learned the stent that we are getting is double the price than what they are selling in Canada. So I think these were the issues which were happening, but I think when the prices were fixed, there also I think they have gone a little above board. because you cannot club everything same. I think they have tried to club that every stent should have same cost. There also is a concern. I am sure that like in developed places where there are more strict regulatory bodies, where they try to sort of approve any kind of devices, there are some price ways of fixing that this may be this much, this may be this much. Maybe we should also look into those kind of practices and see, because you can't club, and this we call Bay effect, to get the good devices here in this particular thing. So I think that's the another thought which was a concern. Anyway, thank you so much for this opportunity.
Thank you, sir, for flagging the issue of reasonable skill and care, which is the requirement to avoid medical negligence claims, and affordable care. I would now like to invite Lieutenant General N.K. Parmar, PVSM, AVSM, Veer Chakra, VSM, formerly our Director General, Armed Forces Medical Services, to speak about ethical issues in relation to disaster management, emergency medical services, and the use of emerging technologies in healthcare provisioning. General Parmar, sir.
Thank you very much. I think I can speak from here.
Sir.
That's what you want. Okay.
I think the advantage of the last few hours in the T20 is that our time is limited and run to be scored is too high. So we'll try our best to limit ourselves to whatever is available to us. First, I would like to touch on the disaster that by mere definition, the disaster has been defined that when the societal resources run short and it exceeds the capacity to handle and you need support from outside. In this, the responsibility of state or as a nation is driven by the doctrine of parens patria, that is the father of the nation, which was derived from the kingdom state. Now it is on the sovereign that you must know where is the risk, where is the vulnerability, what all event can happen, where all it can happen by epidemiological analysis. You put your plans, you put your the entire resource planning, you have a rescue, relief, rehabilitation plan. And whenever situations so demand, you go for the response operations. A lot of ethical dilemmas arise out of this, as well as legal, because when it exceeds your capacity, somebody has to wait, and a deterioration happens. Who's responsible for that deterioration? And it is demanded that the relief in the disaster situation has to be without any discrimination with caste, creed, religion, societal status or the economic constraints. You got to provide those issues. And not only this, that you have to follow it up with the rehabilitation and the entire sequence is to be redrawn. You got to notify that an ethical principle. I would like to draw the example of Bhopal, methyl isocyanate tragedy. If the population was informed of the methyl isocyanate, what effects it has, and if it, in case of a leakage, what they need to do is the wrap of their face with a wet towel would have prevented many more casualties. This information was not shared or not available to the people. There's an ethical dilemma or ethical lapse when not being informed. And in case whatever has happened, I've analyzed Bijwas and Terminal here, the Indian Oil Depot. They had incorporated AIMS into taking their ambulance to evacuate casualty when AIMS do not run the ambulance service and AIMS do not have the burn center available to them. But they have unilaterally co-opted. So information, not availability, co-opting people is the ethical dilemma. And this dilemma is that you're supposed to plan and put to best use the entire resource available. You may have enough number exceed your capacity. You will have to decide who can benefit, who cannot benefit. So there, the ethically, the person, everybody has an equal right, but you have to take this call. That's an ethical dilemma. But if you prepare yourself for every event, preparedness is the key, and the practice is the key in that ethical dilemma and legal practices. When we exceed it to the your emergency care system day-to-day in hospital, there are a lot of dilemmas of similar nature. Emergency department, if one patient walks in or two patients walks in, it's not an issue. when it is overwhelmed by an accident or a clash or something else, again, similar decision has to be made who is to be taken first. The triage is one of the ethical dilemmas. And triage is supposed to be distributive justice. You've got to take it maximum good for maximum people, therefore you decide who gets the priority. If the second person awaiting that develops a sort of a complications or dies, is an ethical responsibility all right, but legally it is not tenable because you've got a certain capacity. So the availability of bed, while awaiting availability of bed for a myocardial infarction case, and he could not get the admission, he could not get the immediate response or treatment, whatever has to be done, is an ethical dilemma as well as legal dilemma. So the staffing, the emergency services with the trained staff, the equipment, to the extent it is within the capability of the hospital, it has to be done. And everyday problem arises in the emergency because of such dilemmas that we manifest. And I think I'll take a last question, the technical issues that arises. That the drug and the technology is evolving with unprecedented speed. The entire knowledge of the other sciences is applied to the medicine now. Whether it is genomic, whether it is nuclear, whether it is electronic, whether it's anything else is being applied, physics, chemistry, everything is being applied in medicine. And many of the technology which has been approved on the fast track basis, on the basis of an assumption of a benefit to the society, later on, a few years back, has turned out to be damaging, not safe, and causing complication, has to be withdrawn. So pre-market approved drug in cardiac devices or cardiac intervention cases, 78 drugs, which is a case reported in JAMA in 2009, that 121 studies, that 71 devices later on found to be deficient when we matched their study population, whatever what was being reflected, what was actually being done, and it had to be withdrawn. Similarly, today, the IVF technology and its induction and many of the problems faced by the child which is born out of the IVF is linked to the technology that has been approved. So the many of the off-shelf the drug that is being used, which is not passing through the FDA, many of the drug, whether it is for the non-recognized disabilities, whether it is psychotic drugs, whether it is something else, is being withdrawn later on because of this. So the safety of the equipment, while procurement and a safety of drug, standardized drug, gone through the entire rigmarole of being certified, is in our the requirement of everybody to ensure that anybody, the clinician now sees a technology on the web or in the Google, then he wants it for next day, which is not the case because unless it is proven safe, useful, and can significantly alter the outcome of the care, then only we should go for those technology. So this is what I have to say because it saves time.
Thank you so much, sir. We move now to Professor Nitin Madhusudan Nagarkar, Director of AIIMS, Raipur. Sir, would you like to speak about the ethical practice as a value-based behavior, and it should ideally be a part of a culture of healthcare? As a Director of AIIMS, would you like to have a culture of ethics in healthcare? Do you suggest any plan of action for its introduction? And as a surgeon of repute, have there been any instances, sir, in your experience where you felt that you were in the gray zone of laws and ethics related to healthcare?
Thank you very much, Colonel Rudra. Again, thanks very much to Professor Shakti Gupta for having invited us here. I think over the years, we know since the history, we listened to the history, the previous speakers have alluded to it, that right from the Egyptian times or even subsequently, we know that the Hippocratic's oath was so important and ethics has been important right from the very beginning, right since the time that we've had our medical profession, because it's something which is directly related to a profession. Our profession gives us certain rights, privileges, but along with these privileges, there are lots of responsibilities, and we have to honor the law of the land as it may be, wherever we are practicing. And that's true for our country also. So what has happened is that over the years, the expectation of the public has changed and will continue to change. The medical practice will also continue to change and evolve. and the younger generation, as they get trained, they have to be trained to the ethics, to the medical ethics, which is relevant for today's time, and they also should be, you know, abreast with how the changes are going to be in coming times. We do have ethics as a subject, and I think forensic medicine, Colonel Rudra is from, is head of forensic medicine department. It's always been part of the MBBS curriculum. However, I think because AIIMS, I'm looking after AIIMS Raipur and Bhopal, we do have the foundation course or the orientation course where they are taught about medical ethics and the soft communication skills, which are going to be important for these careers, for these young doctors in future. And of course, then they come across the subject in forensic medicine. But it's not just for these medical students. It is for medical students, nursing students, the paramedics. And we have medical education technology workshops being conducted regularly so that the faculty members are also sensitized time and again regarding medical ethics. AIIMS has also been conducting, and other institutions of national importance have conducted various CMEs on medical ethics, especially considering the present scenario. So I think that's very relevant. And there are certain issues regarding whether we're talking of organ transplantation, how to handle cases of rape, and so on and so forth. So things have been changing. The new legislation which comes across, they should be aware of that. So I think that regularly these courses, the CME courses on medical ethics, where we have specialists from all walks of life, because it's not just one opinion of the medical profession which is going to matter. We require the legal luminaries, we require the press, we require the general public also giving their opinion, because finally it is their opinion which matters. We have our own perspective about how we work, but we don't work alone, especially doctors who are practicing, they're working in a society. And how the society perceives them or the changes which are occurring will impact either way. So I think that's very important. And that was my first answer. I think as regards my personal experiences, I think anybody who is a surgeon and for many decades who has been operating will come across different scenarios. And I had the occasion of working in different countries also. But for example, I was in Punjab, sir, in the early 90s. And there were times when, you know, different kinds of patients, where you can call them terrorists or whoever they were, they used to come. Sometimes we had to visit the jails and go and see the patients over there inside. And I think we gave them the best possible care. We never thought which kind of individual this particular person is, he or she is. They got the finest medical care. I remember a few who were convicts already awaiting a death sentence. I've operated, at least I remember, two of such patients. Of course, whatever happened later on must be a legal process. But we did our job as a medical professional, considering that this is the condition with which this person has come to us, got admitted, and finally has got discharged, and then sent back to the jail from where he or she came from. The other thing is, was in UK, sir, we used to have the Jehovah's Witnesses, and they would refuse blood transfusion. It's their religious issue. So a couple of patients whom I operated, of course, they did not require blood, but there were certain cases who were going to require blood, and then the patients had finally refused surgery because they knew that blood transfusion would be required. It was a major neck surgery, and then we had to honor the patient's wishes, and so then the surgery was avoided. So certain things which we come across, and the last thing is certain of my very close relatives or very close friends have wanted to get operated from me. Then we have to, you know, just have a discussion with them. We did go ahead, at least where close friends are concerned, or their wives, or their doctors. When you become senior in your profession, sir, it's bound to happen. They will come to you for surgical care as well. And I think that's just a special case, but nothing unusual. We treat them as patients otherwise.
Thank you, sir. That brings us to the close of the panel discussion, and I'll request the chairperson of the session to kindly summarize briefly before we conclude. Sir. Please.
The today's topic has many facets, but what is the required for a professional is ultimately his wisdom, his prudence to deal with a particular situation. I believe that no law can regulate a person's ethics. Ethics is something which is inherent in a person, which comes from within, and your behavior makes a lot of difference. I have seen in various capacities, whether you are a lawyer, you are a doctor, you are a judge, your behavior will make a lot of difference. And particularly doctor, you are treating a human beings. You are not dealing with articles. You are not dealing with the goods. You are dealing with human beings. So ultimately, your behavior makes a patient feel good, and lot of, even if there is some aberration, it will not come to fore, and it will not be visible because of a doctor's behavior. So what is required is a self-regulation, a self-realization, an inherent prudence, which is required, and which is, I believe, is the real ethics. Thank you very much.
Now we request Honorable Justice Pramod Kohli, Chairman, Central Administrative Tribunal, to felicitate the esteemed panelists and the moderator.
We request General N.K. Parma to please accept the token of appreciation on behalf of organizing committee.
We request Dr. K.K. Talwar to please accept the token of appreciation.
We request Professor Nitin Madhusudan Nagarkar to please accept the felicitation.
We request Mr. Anil Anand to please accept a token of appreciation.
We request Colonel Abhijit Rudra to please accept the token of appreciation on behalf of organizing committee. Thank you, sir.
We now request Air Marshal Pavan Kapoor, this is Seva Medal Bar, PHS, DG Medical Services Air, to please come on the stage and felicitate our Honorable Justice Pramod Kohli, Chairman, Central Admission Council. We once again thanks all of our esteemed panelists.